Alrighty, this is Lee here, and you should be able to see my screen. I'm not. I was just sitting here looking at some stuff while I was waiting for the time to come around. I'm not sure what you're looking at. Nothing, nothing that an 8-year-old can look at. And also, you should be able to hear me. So, could you please just let me know in the chat, "Hey Lee, I can hear you. I can see you. Awesome." Video in bed. Oh, yeah. Hang on a minute. If I'd move all these stupid GoToWebinar boxes, I could see. Yeah, I was just messing around with this, guys. Today, let me introduce. I'm so excited about so many topics that I'm likely just to, like fly off the handle. But anyway, my name's Lee Cole. Today is our Monday, 3 o'clock Eastern Standard Time Q&A. I've got some good questions that people have already sent me. I've been talking to Blue Streak today, so I'm drinking some water. So if you hear a gulp gulp noise, that's me. I'll try to keep that to a minimum. And today we've got our Q&A, and got a ton of stuff that I want to tell you about. But while I was waiting for the webinar to start, I was just looking at I've got TubeBuddy. I've got what's called a pro account. Although I just realized that I could pay more money and have even more functionality. But and I was looking at all of this stuff, and they got advanced video embed. So this is where you can get the embed code, which is a pain in the butt to figure out on your own, but you can do all kinds of cool stuff with that. So I was sitting around playing around with that whilst waiting on you guys. So how are you? I hear from my buddy Ake in Tennessee. Who else have I got on here? Don, Bob, Kim, Michelle, Nate, Richard, Steve. Anybody else hear me? So, somebody say hello, Lee. So that I mean, I'm happy to talk to Ake. He's a great guy, but just so I know that we're actually communicating. Yes, no, maybe. Y'all there? Is there blood pumping? Do we need to get on Amazon and get you a home defibrillator? Make sure that you're act. Jessica just got on. How are you? This is being recorded and will be in the playlist available for you for the new people, because I've got some names of some people who I think have not been on, not that one, have not been on a Monday Q&A. Let me show you something real fast. That you'll want to know about. This is the page that you use to sign up on. So if you will go to this same page, Don, how you doing, buddy? If you'll go to this same page, and let me pop that in the chat for you. You don't have to do that right now. I just want you to understand where it is. And if you will scroll all the way down here, you can click here to watch past episodes. And I'm doing this every week. Now, granted, last week I just had some family stuff and it just didn't happen. But let's say 19 weeks out of 20, I will be here doing this every Monday morning. But if you want to see all the cool stuff on the past episodes, you can look here. And all this is a playlist, and I'm just gonna post everything to this playlist, and you will have all of this available to you. So, cool beans. Got some things I want to talk about before we get rolling. One, my new launch, Offline Email Empire. NLP stands for Neuro-Linguistic Programming. This thing's going great guns. If you are interested in a really, really simple and much needed service to sell to local businesses, which is email marketing management, you need to pay close attention to this. As a matter of fact, I will put this in the chat also, because I've broken it all down. Exactly what you need to do, how you need to do it. It's a very simple service that I've sold businesses for years now. They love it. You can charge good money for it. You can build a recurring income with it. And it also comes with my new software, which actually writes emails for you, which is really sweet. We had some software that we sold last year, which was quite good software. This is a massive upgrade over that. I'm not going to bore you with the details, guys. I want to get to the Q&A in a second, but just so that you can see how cool the software is, here I am inside some website of ours. It's a plugin for WordPress. You know, you got settings, et cetera, but just real quick, right off the cuff, this is just the one, this is the instance of the software that I was using to shoot the videos with. But you can create emails using three really important structures that copywriters use: problem, agitation, solution, problem, solution, and attention, interest, desire, and action. But we have NLPized this stuff. And if you know anything about persuasion or anything like that, that should excite you a lot. Essentially, just go down through here. It basically what this does is this breaks up the writing into fields and makes sure that you think like me. I have studied copywriting for probably close to 15 years now. I have been professionally doing copywriting for over 10 years now. I don't do it as a freelance copywriter. I haven't done it as a freelance copywriter in probably the past 5 years or so, but just because I'm too busy with other stuff. But this software basically lets you have my brain, all right? Which is a pretty cool thing. Once you write an email, you can view it here, and I'm not going to sit here and read this to you because that would be a little boring. And you can also edit that email, and it brings up, see how easy this is to use? Brings up, you know, this where you can go here and fix little issues, et cetera, et cetera. So that is for sale through Matthew. How are you? That is for sale through August the 2nd. It will be for sale after August the 2nd. You'll just be paying approximately twice as much for it after August the 2nd. So I would encourage you to go ahead and get this while you can. Cool beans. So hang on, let me look at my little list of stuff, which is sitting here on my phone. I've got this new iPhone. It's an iPhone 8X. I haven't bought a new phone in like 5 years, and my other phone seemed tiny compared to everybody else's. So now I've got my little list of stuff I want to talk about right here. Okay, cool beans. Matthew, you had a fabulous question last time. Yes. Thank you so much for reminding me of that, guys. For those of you who bought Offline Email Goldmine, which was last year's version of this, this training, Offline Email Empire, in other words, the one that I just showed you, the trainings do not overlap. As a matter of fact, Empire just takes this whole thing to just a whole nother level. And the software is completely reprogrammed. I think has a much slicker, much more user-friendly user interface, and also has the email the NLP stuff in it. And if you will log in to the members area for Offline Email Goldmine, the one that you might have bought last year, you will see a link that you can click, which will take you to that same sales page. But when you click the buy button, it will give you a nice discount. Okay, because I always try to treat my past customers right. So my past folks that bought this, you get a nice discount on the upgraded version. Thank you, Matthew, for reminding me of that. Matthew had a wonderful question. Actually, it's 2 weeks ago, but in our last session, to niche. It's on both, Matthew. It's on both the new and the old. It's according to when you bought it. Guys, as of about a year ago, I created a new membership site. The old one I created, God knows, 2011, back before I knew what I'm doing, what I was doing, and it's just got a ton of bugs in it. I'm looking to try to move that thing. It is remarkably difficult to even fathom moving, and I'm trying not to retire it. I told everybody I was going to retire it at the end of last year and the beginning of this year, and I'm trying really hard not to retire it. But it's just got some technical issues, so we're trying to move it. The really old stuff is over there. Anything that you bought from this time last year up through now, and from now up until the future, is on a much a much more sane website and much easier to use both for us and for you. But according to when you bought it, Matthew, it's going to be either the old one or the new one. And if anybody lost a login, just hit us up in support. I'm happy to give me your PayPal email address. I'm happy to look it up and send you your login. Okay. So, Matthew, you had a wonderful question. And guys, if you have questions, you know, gee, Lee, I wish you'd talk about this, that, and the other thing. Just pop it in the, you know, pop it in the chat here. This is, you know, Q&A. This is a free form thing. I come to this every week with a question that someone's probably asked me, and I'm thinking, yeah, well, you know, unless somebody asks me something else brilliant, I'll talk about that. But, so, you know, I mean, this is, we're getting there. So, feel free. This is open. I wish we could all talk. That's, you know, bandwidth wise and just, you know, I mean, it's just not going to work to do that, unfortunately, but maybe technology will get someday to where we can do that. Zoom could almost do that, but maybe I'll look into that. But anyway, today's question. So if you got another question, let me know and I'll see if I can cover it before. I like these things to go 30, 45 minutes. Today's question, to niche or not to niche, or for Matthew, to niche or not to niche? That is the question. And what Matthew meant by that on our last session is, Matthew, correct me if I'm wrong, should you specialize in a given business niche? In other words, should you, I'm not calling this one out, but should you just sell to medium-sized to small-size accountancy firms, all right? Should you just sell to upscale hairdressers? Should you just sell to chiropractors? You know, chiropractors is like the dog training of the offline world. You know, should you just sell to chiropractors? And I was, you know, Matthew, you asked that question last week, and I think I stumbled around with it a lot. It was such a fabulous question. I wanted to, you know, kind of save it for this week. And I was actually thinking about it a couple of days ago whilst I was walking my dog. And so it's kind of like this. I mean, this is the way it breaks down for me. If you have if you have a prior, this is what I would tell somebody. If you have a prior relationship with a business or you have prior experience with a given kind of business, okay? So like two lifetimes ago, I was a real estate agent here in the United States. I worked with RE/MAX for about a decade, for 10 years. Actually, a little over 10 years, something like that. But anyway. Loved the business. I mean, it's a hell of a way to make money. I mean, it's like a 70, 80 hour a week gig, right? Otherwise, I might even do that now. I really like the business, but it's a killer. But, you know, I deeply understand the minds of real estate agents and the minds of real estate brokers. I don't have it anymore. I mean, it expired, but I used to have a broker's license. I understand how the business works. I mean, I was, you know, just doing that 24/7 for like a decade. And so, you know, somebody like that, it would make sense that you might feel very comfortable going after that kind of business. Okay. I mean, in a large city, I mean, even in a medium-sized city, but in a large city, there's enough real estate agents and brokerages, especially now with the internet and things are just carved up so differently than the way they used to be, that you would, I mean, like in Atlanta, which is only a city of 6 million people, you would literally never run out of clients ever. And it would make sense, like, you know, if I really wanted to just stop everything and just focus on that, to build a business serving that niche. That would make sense because I personally have an enormous amount of understanding of that. I had a coaching student about a year ago who had a background in like financial services. knew a ton of people in financial services, had been in various financial service type jobs for, a guy probably in his 40s or 50s, something like that, just guessing. Knew a bunch of people in financial services, had a lot of contacts in financial services. And so it made sense for him to focus in on financial services. What worries me about just from the get-go deciding, well, Lee said that real estate agents make great clients. They do for Lee. They really do for Lee because I'm Lee. Because I know how they talk and think. I really know what's important to them. Like I said, I used to be one. I mean, I know what they're going to say before they even open their mouths. I know where their heads and hearts are. You take somebody with a different personality and a different background. Let's say somebody that spent their lives doing IT stuff for small to medium-sized companies, or let's say just medium-sized companies, because small companies generally have to farm that out in different ways. But like a medium-sized company, is that person, like an I okay, most of my friends, I have several friends who are like IT professionals, work for medium to large-sized corporations. Their personalities are like the polar opposite of a real estate agent, literally. I mean, we used to joke about people like that. I mean, they're fine, because they always pay their bills on time, they got good credit, and they can make a rational decision. But my God, I mean, it's like their emotions are just like completely for generally. We're talking about that kind of person, engineers, people like that, I mean, Jesus Christ, they I mean, I've had more than one come to when we were deciding which house to make an offer on, just sit down with what essentially at the time amounted to a spreadsheet. And I mean, that's not how real estate agents think at all. Real estate agents are huge, big picture people. They are very emotionally driven. They are remarkably focused on the bottom line. I mean, they are kind of like, I mean, in a good way, they're kind of like, I don't mean this in a bad way, but in a good way, they're like a predator fish, like a barracuda or something. They're just swimming, 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 see a fish, bam, find somebody who needs to buy a house, get their butt in the car, let's show them a bunch of houses, bam, got another one under contract. Then you do it all over again, right? Okay, somebody wants to sell their house, do a listing presentation, bam, sign in the yard. 2 weeks later, bam, they get Lee's special letter that they have to lower their price in order to sell it. Yeah, I had mastered that too. And then we lower the price 3 weeks later. This was because I was a real estate agent back during a major recession. And then bam, the house is gone. They're like that. Your IT professional, your engineer, your person that connects the dots, does the spreadsheet, does all the rational thinking, might maybe have a pulse. I don't know. It's an entirely different way of thinking. So, if that's your personality, I mean, nobody can tell you, Matthew, and everybody else, that this certain business is great and you need to go after that business because these guys will hire you in a nanosecond. And everybody just ought to be serving fill in the blank type business. I mean, that's just stupid. Literally, that's just stupid. Okay. Different kinds of business owners, like as groups, I mean, and real estate agents are quasi business owners, but different kind of business owners, they have different kinds of personalities. And if your personality doesn't in general, just sort of dovetail with the general personality of that group, you're probably not going to do that well trying to serve them. Given the fact that unless you're Hannibal Lecter, you've probably got a personality that they're like, at least a couple of billion duplicates of out there in this great big world of ours. In other words, I'm saying, given the fact that the fill in the dots spreadsheet, emotionless, extremely rational thinking person can go find a bunch of those people and sell their stuff to them. And the big picture sign on the dotted line, predator, fish, barracuda type, I don't mean that in a bad way. they can go find a bunch of them too, right? So, I mean, like I and my offline business, I really like I really like entrepreneurs who started their businesses with absolute zero, except just major cojones, and they really didn't know what they're doing, and they just sort of fumbled their way into, making a really nice business that probably went bankrupt, probably might have come close to bankruptcy a couple of times. They're big picture people. They're capable of rational thinking, but they understand that in the world of decisions, emotions rule the day. What am I describing? I'm describing a lot of different kinds of business owners and managers, but I'm describing my own personality. See. So if you get that mismatch, I don't think it's going to work too well for you. And that's really what I was talking to this guy in the financial services. He was just beating his head against the wall. And I said, "Well, who are you talking to?" I've forgotten who he was talking to. I said, "Who are you talking to?" And he said, "Well, I'm talking to businesses like this." And then I thought, "Well, no, you know what, Sherlock? I mean, it's obvious why that's not happening, because those people look at you and think, Jesus, I'm sitting here watching a person, talking to a person who's just about as interesting as watching paint dry, right?" And I never did, Steve. I never did nearly go bankrupt, but I'm a little too careful for that. But I deeply identify with people with people with that much vision. Okay, and P I deeply identify, Steve, with people who jump off the building and then say, "Well, crap! I think I need to invent this thing called a parachute on the way down." I really identify with entrepreneurs. Okay. I mean, just deeply. And that not with all, not even with the majority, but that's just part of the personality type. Fortunately, I also balance that with an enormous amount of common sense too. So, that's, what color should the parachute be? Exactly. So that's my point, guys. I mean, nobody can say, go after X kind of business. Now, this really was not Matthew's entire question. Matthew was saying, should you focus on some niche? And I just answered that, well, there's some niches that you should not focus on. Okay, but should you focus on some niche? You know, what worries me about this, because a lot of people on my list, a lot of you guys on my webinars and stuff, I'm thinking 80%, maybe more, not all, okay? A lot of you, it's going to be somewhere between 50 and 80%. A lot of you are still getting your businesses off the ground, all right? You don't have 20 clients, all right? You're still kind of, you may have one or two, but you're still getting it off the ground. And, for me to say, when you're trying to get the damn car moving, okay, I taught my son how to drive on a car with a clutch because I wanted to make sure that he could drive a straight shift. That you ever tried to teach a teenager how to drive with a stick? There's an exercise in patience. But I was just had this idea of, when you if you know how to drive a stick, and the first time you learn to drive a stick, and the car lurches and lurches and lurches. If that's where you are in your business, I don't think you need to choose a niche. I don't think you know enough to choose a niche, frankly. I don't think you know enough about yourself to choose a niche. Okay, I mean, I think the I think you need more experience just being out there as a newbie. Alan, we'll get to that in a second. As you can see, I was up here looking at TubeBuddy. I have TubeBuddy on my YouTube channel. We'll see if we got enough time to get to that one. If not, save that for next time, because that's a good thing to talk about. I may run out of time because Matthew has a very important this is a really important question that Matthew's talking about. So, when you're new, Michelle, you probably have more patience than I do. When you're new, I think you should go out there. I'm not done with the answer yet. Okay. I think you should go out there, and I think you should just land whatever business you can, And then I think you should see how you sort of relate to business owners in different types of businesses. And then I think you should see how who you really enjoy being around. I mean, not individuals, but business types, right? Like I, real estate agents, I mean, I still got friends from back 20 years ago when I was in real estate, just really dear friends of mine. I mean, if I decided for some insane reason to go back in that business, it would be insane because I'd have to work 70 hours a week. That wouldn't be insane. But if I did that, I mean, I would just enjoy the heck out of being in around those people. Okay. I really like those people. Okay. Yep, Rick. I want to mention that too. That's excellent. So my point is, when you're new, I think you need to get whatever business you can. And I think you need to notice, like, be aware of where it's easy and where it's hard. Right? Now it could be hard, like dealing with a business owner because you didn't qualify them enough, and they're just jerks, right? At which point you just need to fire them, give them their money back, and move on, frankly. But it could be hard just because you don't deal with that personality that well. Okay, so this is why I've never had a ton of accountants for clients. It's not that I don't like accountants, it's just that I scare them. All right, I'm too loud. I scare them. All right, they get worried. The ideas are popping off all over the place. They can't deal with that. All right, they have to do things sequential. Right. Let's digest this thing that you just said first before we move on to the next thing. I'm saying 15 things at one time. All right. So there's that issue. There's that issue. Okay. So I think really when you're getting started, or really not just started, but when you know how in the trades in the United States, in the trades, I don't know what they call the first level of person, an apprentice, you're a journeyman, and then you're a master. Like if you want to be a master plumber, apprentice plumber, journeyman plumber, or journey person plumber, maybe nowadays, and then a master plumber. Well, I would say up until when you're like a halfway through the journey person stage, in other words, you've got some competence, but you're not quite yet a master. That's maybe when you need to kick back and say, I really like dealing with these kinds of business owners. And it may not be one type of business. It may be businesses where there's a lot of commonality, right? Real estate agents, insurance agents somewhat, but also public speakers, people creating personal platforms online and stuff like that. All those people think very much alike. They're all huge picture people. They're all idea people. Okay, I get along with those people extremely well. All right. So I think you got that. Now, one thing that I think though, and this is like the big revelation I had whilst. Notice I'm saying the English whilst like that. It's because my daughter is currently studying in Oxford. So I'm deciding to, exactly. I'm deciding to buff up my English a little bit so that I'll, not seem too much of a redneck when she gets home. But anyway, one thing that I think you absolutely should do from the get-go, maybe not the first day. Okay, but you absolutely should do this from the get-go, is I think you should choose probably one, at most two, methods of prospecting. I think you really, really, really need to do that. There is so much nuance. Rick, I'm gonna read that out too in about 2 seconds. There's so much nuance to this, whether it's direct mail. Direct mail is a matter of not only we're talking about physical mail. Direct mail is a matter of not only massaging the message, what the wrapper, the envelope looks like, and all that stuff, but it's also a matter of budgeting your money, right? So if that appeals to you, then I think you need to stick with direct mail for at least 6 months. LinkedIn, If you're, if you like LinkedIn, I think you should just do LinkedIn. I really like to meet people in person. So, and I love LinkedIn too. But for me, another good idea would be network meetings. Of course, I live in a fairly large city. I can get to a ton of network meetings fairly easily. But I think I think it's extremely important, and for your niche, not to necessarily worry about a consistency of the kind of business you're talking to or business person you're talking to, but a consistency of how you get to them. Okay, of the essential, this is essentially the idea of the funnel. In other words, how you get to that business person. Because I don't care what it is you're doing. I mean, if it's going to three network meetings a week, if it's spending 3 hours a day on LinkedIn, if it's sending out 50 highly targeted direct mail letters or direct mail envelopes or packages or however the hell you're going to do that per week, however you're doing that, okay, it's going to take you really 2 or 3 months before you get that thing tightened down to where you absolutely know what you're doing, to where you know your numbers. Okay, if I send out this many letters, it's going to cost me that amount of much amount of money. I'm going to get a client from this mailing statistically 4 to 5 weeks from now. That's when I get the money back. So then I have to have 4 to 5 weeks of cash in the bank for the mailing, to where you totally understand all the little nuances of that thing. Ditto LinkedIn, to where you I sit down, I you know I connect with this many people, I message that many people, I know how to follow up with people, I know who to follow up with, all of that stuff. Network meetings, to where you got it down to it's a mindless science. I go to the network meeting, I know how to collect cards, I know how to call people back, I know how to set appointments, to where that's just duck soup, right? I mean, that literally is duck soup. It's a no-brainer. I've got it all figured out. That would be, to my mind, so much more important for you than to decide that, well, the latest thing that I bought because somebody sent me an email says that XYZ business is the perfect business. Well, maybe it is for them, and it might be for you, but for a lot of people, it's not going to be because of the personality thing. So, Rick said a couple of things while I was talking about Matthew. This was such a wonderful question. Thank you so much for this. Rick said, good to have multiple streams of income so you don't end up in a niche going through problems. Yes, in other words, as you're figuring this stuff out, and that Rick works both for should I approach XYZ kind of business or should I have a certain type of approach? Okay, I mean, there is a learning curve. All right. So you do need some money in the bank while you're going through the learning curve. Of course, when you're getting started, you have no choice but to go through the learning curve, right? So just go through the learning curve. And Rick also says, also find out what services you like to offer. Oh, amen to that. That is really important too. What things do you like to offer and what you don't? I started out selling people SEO and that went on for about a year. And then I decided I hated that. I mean, that was literally like when I can make more money selling other stuff where it doesn't change. I don't wake up in the morning and Google's changed something, I mean, I could just sell something like email marketing management where it's not changing, I mean, all you do is just figure out what this month's emails are going to be, get those written, write them yourself, whatever, load those up and bam, you're done, right? I mean, except for Armageddon, there's not a lot changing that's going to affect that thing. But I started out selling SEO and I literally hated it because, I mean, it was a pain in the ass. It was getting harder to do. It was getting more expensive. People didn't understand it was getting more expensive and stuff like that. Other people may like it. I'm not saying that you should not sell SEO at all. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that it wasn't for me because I thought there were too many variables in it for me. I don't like variables. I'm really, really highly aware of making the same or more money while reducing the number of variables in doing that because that makes for an income stream that's just a lot easier. Yeah. Okay, cool. So we're right at 35 minutes. We give it 10 more minutes or so, 5 minutes if you got another quick question. By the way, you're sitting here looking at my YouTube account because I'm starting the process of just blowing this bad boy out. And while we are at it, why don't you go ahead and subscribe to this because we are rapidly adding a lot of really cool content to this. You may already be subscribed, but if you aren't subscribed, I just put a link in the chat and click on that and subscribe. We're building out playlists with a lot of free stuff. Like I'm starting a new playlist, LinkedIn tutorials for beginners, which just really sounds like it's for beginners. It's something that a lot of people could seriously use. So cool beans. Anything I can help you with? We got like 4 more minutes. Somebody give me a quick something to talk about. A quick question. Alan, I think we're going to have your question for next time. If you would just hit me up next time. I don't really. Alan says, is there a search tool for YouTube like Google Keyword Planner for Google? I don't really know of one that works exactly like this on TubeBuddy. Where was that? So I have a pro account, I think. Is this how I got to that? And I can't see where was I. I haven't used this a ton, but I was looking at some stuff and thought that it was here, Alan. This is why I'm thinking this probably would be a good question for next time because I would be prepared to actually answer it. Search positions. Was that it? No, that's for the that's for that video. Anywho, well, you could Google it, but actually in TubeBuddy there is something kind of like what Alan's talking about. Is cold email prospecting still good? Is LinkedIn really feasible for free users anymore? Let's hit those real fast and call it a day. Is cold email prospecting still good, James? Yes, it takes a really big front end to that to make it work. Let me explain what I mean by that. I've got friends who thrive on cold email prospecting, but they have a lot of software scraping emails. And then you have to clean the emails because you're invariably going to scrape a bunch of emails that don't exist anymore. You're going to scrape spam traps, which are emails that are known to be not real emails that are monitored by all the email clients like, Yahoo, Google, and all that stuff. Because they figure that if you're emailing to that email that they know damn well is not a real email, then you're a spammer. Okay. So then they're just going to shut down your IP address or addresses coming into, Gmail or whatever. So you got to get rid of that stuff. So you have to know how to identify and get rid of that stuff. And you're looking at an ungodly number of emails going out. I wish I was talking with a friend of mine about her numbers, specific numbers a few months ago, and I can't remember them well enough to really quote them here. But it is a big production. Now it works, all right? Is it completely legal? I'm not too sure about that. Does it work? Yes, it works, but you have but there's a lot that precedes if you want to make it work. Yeah, it was about that, Matthew. It was 20 to 30,000 emails going out every week. So James, in other words, you're going to have to scrape, let's say you send out 20,000 emails every week. Okay. Then you're going to have to scrape like 50,000 or 60 to get down to the 20. All right. Because, a whole ton of them are just not going to be good anymore. Steve, I have in the past. I don't use that right now. LinkedIn feasible for free users anymore? Michelle, yes, it is. I would look forward to, if I were you, getting my feet wet with LinkedIn through building out your connections, through content marketing and stuff like that. But what I would look forward to is, and Michelle, I don't know where you are in your business. You could be making $20,000 a month or $0 a month. I don't know. So you're going to have to take this answer and apply it to wherever you are. If you're making $20,000 a month, Michelle, go ahead and get Sales Navigator. It's only 80 bucks a month. It won't kill you, okay? But if you're making $0 a month, then, you know, and the budget's tight, then $80 a month, I mean, that's kind of a big step, right? So what I would do is I would start off with a free account. And then as I started landing deals and making real money, I would put aside some of that and then I would get Sales Navigator. LinkedIn has basically, after Microsoft bought LinkedIn, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with this. I mean, it makes total sense. But basically, they took a lot of those services that were available, let's say 3 years ago in the free account, and they pushed them up into the paid accounts, which makes total sense. They've got like, what, over 500 million users, so they might as well milk more money out of the thing. It's exactly what I would have done. But so you don't have available to you as much as you used to in terms of search and, you know, stuff like that, but you can still get going. I mean, you can definitely get going with a free account. You do not need to right off the bat just, you know, start paying for Sales Navigator or not use LinkedIn because you can't pay for Sales Navigator. I mean, one of those two, you don't need to do that. You can get going with a free account and do very, very well with it. As a matter of fact, I'm going to be doing a sometime in the next few weeks. I was talking to Steve Rosenbaum, who's a good friend of mine. Y'all may know that name, but I was talking to Steve about him showing me some cool LinkedIn stuff that he's been doing with free accounts. And we're going to, you know, do a screen like an over the shoulder dealy of that whole thing. And, you know, that would be something that you might be interested in. We hadn't scheduled a time for that. That would be a few weeks from now, though. Cool. Steve, I think I answered that. Yeah, and Ake says you can use Sales Navigator free for 1 month. Yeah. Of course, it's not going to do you any good if you just, you know, don't do anything for a month, right? but if you take that month and put the pedal to the metal, then I can't help but think, Michelle, that you would have enough clients at the end of the month. I mean, all it would take is one to make sense to pay 80 bucks for the next one, right? So I think it'd be more important to really know what you're selling, know why you're selling it, have something easy to sell. Cool beans, guys. This one's in the books. You know, we download it, we upload it back to YouTube. It will be on the playlist, available to you through the URL that I showed you earlier, the same one that you used to sign up with. And I will see you guys next week. Make sure that you buy Offline Email Empire before August the 2nd. I mean, you can buy it after that. I'll make more money. But if you want to save some money on a phenomenal product, make sure you buy that before August the 2nd. In other words, you've got 1, 2, 3 more days to buy that. Awesome. Y'all are fabulous. Talk to you soon. Really enjoyed it. See you later.